Well, this is the last day of September in 2011, and today will mark the 90th day this summer that we've gone over 100 degrees here in Austin. And I can't take it. I have just been one grumpy dude for the last, for a while. This is my 27th summer working outside, and I've never, ever seen anything like this. We're at 160 days over 90 this year. 90's not bad, but when it's over 100 with some humidity like we have here in Austin, it's just miserable. And the older I get, the less I can tolerate it. My Nordic genes just don't like it anymore. Well, Sue and I broke down and we bought ourselves a giant flat screen TV, primarily for her work as a social media consultant, so she can give conferences, her computer's going to hook up to it and everything, but I will certainly enjoy it too for watching the Dallas Cowboys, even though they're constantly disappointing me. But I do like to watch pro football. It's something I really enjoy, and so it's going to be great. But we need a place to put the cable box, the Blu-ray player, all the other components that are going to go with this. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a wall-mounted component place for all the components, and then for a place for the speakers to sit on top of. But I don't want it to sit on the ground. I want it to be floating and attached to the wall. So I've got some pieces of pretty rough 8/4 SIPO African mahogany is probably another pretty close name to it. I bought it as SIPO, but that's I think it's also considered African mahogany. These boards have a lot of checks and stuff in them. This is left over from about 1,000 board feet I bought 5 or 6 years ago, and that I just really couldn't work into one of my customers' jobs. But I'm gonna make it work for me. But I'm gonna make so the boards are 8 feet long, and they're about, I have an 8-inch joiner, so that's as wide as I can join. So I'd like for my piece, when it's done, so this is the top view, so I wanna cut this arc in it, so it's about 16 inches here. These are all maximum dimensions. I'm sure it's not gonna end up these dimensions. Like, I have 8 feet here, and there's no way after I cut the cracks and the damage off the end. So, these are just my maximum dimensions that I'm starting off with, and everything is going to be modified as I get it down. So I'm looking at about 10 inches here on the smallest part, and 16 inches in the middle of the arc. And now this is looking straight on into it, and so these are going to be some places for components. I'm going to dovetail the ends of the boxes to create the end of the box. I'm going to have the tails going on the end, so I'll have the pins here, so it'll lock on like this to fight gravity. Then these are going to be sliding dovetail partitions in here that are going to give the box strength. And also, if my panels end up being not just perfectly flat because this is some funky material, if these are cut accurately to the shoulder length of the dovetailed ends, I can pull this panel flat, or certainly flat enough for it to look perfect. All right, these boards are really pretty rough. I'm going to make them look good, but they've got a lot of surface checks in it. This one especially has some real bad checks in it. So this one will probably be the bottom, and I'm hoping that I can make this one be the top, although this one has its own problem in that it has a big curve in the board, and it also has twist in the board. And I like to use this. I have this 9-foot aluminum straight edge. It's really light, and I always just use it as a marker. Some people like to use chalk lines, or in Japanese woodworking they use ink lines, but I've never liked that. I end up making a mess with those things. I get the chalk all over the place. I have it on my face and in my hair, and the ink is even worse. I get that ink everywhere, and I'm just not good enough with it. I didn't grow up using it. So I'll just clamp this on here. I'll use a pencil and I'll just make myself a mark, and I'll just cut this right apart on my Hitachi resaw machine. And so I'll just use it kind of as a straight line cutter. is a straight line ripping machine. So here are my two boards ready to get put on the resaw machine, and I'm just going to trim. You know, it's just so much easier just to waste this, really trim it freehand really quickly, than to try to pass that big heavy joiner, pass this big heavy board over the joiner to get it straight. And it's kind of dangerous and not accurate to do it on the table saw, so you'll see how easy this is. And then of course this one, I'm just going to split it down the middle. Okay, here's my CB75F getting ready to make these cuts. And I always want to reiterate whenever I use this machine, I mean, look at this blade. This blade is nothing to mess with. This thing could cut your hand off before you knew what was happening. You wouldn't even realize it would happen so fast. I mean, those teeth are a little bit more than 1 inch apart, and the aggressiveness of this blade, even though the motor isn't really powerful, if the machine is running in tune, it will cut just about anything you put in its way. So again, you know, here's my machine. It's on wheels. It's about 350 pounds, so it's not too heavy to move around. And I don't use it every day, but I use it a lot, and just for people that work with solid wood, it's just a dream. So here's my work table that I use as my outfeed table, also for my table saw. And in my small shop, everything that I have is at 40 inches above the ground. So one machine can always act as an outfeed or a support for another. So every one of my machines works like this, including my vacuum station, my Festool table that's back there in the corner. Everything is at 1 meter, about 40 inches. And that's a really good height for me because I'm about 6'1". Okay, so I just want to say that one more time before I turn this machine on and you see me cut this. This machine is nothing to play with. I mean, if you, again, I will say it, it would cut your hand off before you knew what was happening. Okay, I'm just going to get this fence out of the way. It's this beautiful rack and pinion fence. And I'm just going to take this here and put it down here on my platform down below. I don't need it because I'm just freehanding these guys through. I'm just going to feed it. And, you know, the real beauty of this machine is you can stop what you're doing. You can leave the machine running. You can go to the other side because all of the action is down into the saw. Nothing is kicking and moving like on a table saw. And also, consequently, all the dust is going down. And the way I have my machine modified, you'll see how little dust comes off the machine. And so I'm going to turn the collector on and I'm going to make these cuts. I'm going to cut this one in half and then I'm going to trim these two garbage ends off of these. I didn't have to remove all of this material on the joiner, and to try to pass something over the table saw freehand like that without first attaching it to a straight edge board, which is always a pain to do. This is a real time saver, this machine. It's a time saver and a money maker. Okay, so the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go join these boards. I'm going to leave this set up right here, because then I'm going to come back and I'm going to resaw the boards this way, standing up on their edge.